Hello, everyone, and welcome to Nettle, the best platform around for distance learning in business, finance, economics, and much, much more. My name is Sava, and today we're going to discuss the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test, a very handy statistical test that can be used to check whether your beliefs about how particular data is distributed are correct. And it might seem at first as a very, very nerdy topic, but bear with me. This is very important in finance in particular, as many theories and models that you're using in finance, like value at risk or modern portfolio theory with efficient frontiers, and even something as frequently used as the capital asset pricing model, have in their inherent assumption that the returns of assets are normally distributed. So the returns follow normal distribution. Kolmogorov-Smirnov test can be used to assess how believable is this claim. Are the returns really normally distributed or not? Because it has a lot of implications for the applicability of well-known and frequently used models. Without further ado, let me show you how to easily apply Kolmogorov-Smirnov test in Excel. I've got daily returns of the famous American benchmark S&P 500, that has weighted average returns of large 500 American companies, and I've got it daily from the start of December 2014 all the way until end of November 2019. Let's figure out if the returns of S&P 500 are normally distributed or not. To do that first, we need to sort the returns from lowest to highest. To do that, let's just copy the returns, paste them here as values, and apply the sorting function in Excel. To do that, we need to go to Data tab, click Sort, continue with the current selection, and sort our values smallest to largest. And we see that the absolute worst daily return of S&P 500 in those 5 years was -4.1%, and the best was 4.96%. It doesn't tell us anyone about the distribution, but it's at least handy to know. Now we need to rank those observations. Well, that's quite straightforward, as we already have them sorted from smallest to largest. So the lowest observation will have a rank of 1, the second lowest will have a rank of 2, and we'll continue on until the very last, that will have a rank of 1,258. Now we need to calculate the observed mean return, so average return, and the standard deviation of returns to figure out what the normal distribution with this mean and standard deviation will look like, and to compare how the actual return are distributed compared to this hypothetical case. So our mean is just the average of our returns, and our standard deviation, we need to apply the sample standard deviation function, is 0.85%. Also, we need our number of observations, and we kind of know that as the rank of our highest observation is 1,258, but we can just count our observations and see that that indeed. Our empirical distribution function is based on our ranks. The distribution function in mathematical statistics is just a function that shows which the proportion of observations that are equal to or smaller than this particular observation. So for the first observation, the proportion of the data that is equal to or smaller than that is just 1 over total number of observations, which is 1,258. And we need to log that because there are 1,258 observations. So only this observation is equal to or lower than itself. And we need to apply that, and our empirical distribution function will appear on the chart over here. So now we need to figure out what would be the theoretical distribution. That is, what would we observe if these returns were indeed normally distributed? To do that, we need to apply the norm dist function and see what would be the distribution function value for an observation that is equal to the current observation, for a normal distribution with mean equal to the empirically observed mean, and the standard deviation equal to the empirically observed standard deviation. And we need to log those two so that we can get the value of the function for all of our observations. And we need to put 1 over here, as we need the cumulative distribution function, not the probability density function. We press enter, and we bottom right click to see the values of the theoretical distribution function for all of our observations. And on the chart to our right, we can see that there are some notable differences between the theoretical distribution and the empirical distribution. The fit of the normal distribution cumulative function into our empirical data is not that good. But how good or how bad is that? To determine that, we need to apply the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test. The Kolmogorov-Smirnov test uses a test statistic that is based on supremum. Supremum might seem as an unnecessarily complicated word, and I agree with you. The supremum is just the maximum absolute difference between the values of the empirical distribution and the theoretical distribution for the data points. So to figure that out, we first need to calculate this absolute difference for every single data point in our sample. So the absolute difference between the empirical distribution and the theoretical distribution. And we apply it for all of our observations, all of our data points. And now we can calculate the supremum, which is equal to the maximum of those values. And we can see that at maximum, the empirical distribution and the theoretical distributions deviate by over 10%. Well, what does it mean? How bad does the normal distribution fit the data? Well, what do these 10% mean for the goodness of fit? How off is the empirical distribution from the theoretical distribution? In other words, what is the probability of this deviation occurring to random chance? What is the probability that the returns of S&P 500 are actually normally distributed? To answer this question, we need to calculate the Kolmogorov-Smirnov statistic. The Kolmogorov-Smirnov statistic is just the supremum times the square root of the number of observations. And this is the observed value of Kolmogorov-Smirnov statistic. As in all hypothesis testing, we could compare the critical value and the observed value to determine if the difference between distributions is significant at 1%. The critical value for the distribution at 1% is just slightly above 1.5, and our observed statistic is 3.6. So from there, we can determine that our distribution fits the data very, very poorly, meaning that the returns of S&P 500 are indeed not normally distributed. But there is another way of making sense of supremum and the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test. There is a formula that can show us what is exactly the probability of the returns of S&P 500 being normally distributed. We already know that the probability is less than 1%, don't we? As our statistic is greater than the critical value. But what is the exact probability? Well, there is a formula for that. And it might seem quite complicated, but bear with me. It is just the exponent, so e to the power of, minus the supremum squared times the number of observations. And having applied this formula, we can see that the probability is indeed very, very small. We can make sense of it by increasing the number of decimal places, and we can see that it's less than 0.2%. So indeed, it is very, very unlikely that the returns of this major American stock market benchmark are normal. So it means a lot for the applicability of commonly used models like value at risk and modern portfolio theory, but it's also a really good case of showing how concepts from mathematical statistics that are, at first glance, overly nerdy and complicated, and how they can be applied to the real world of finance. Hope this was helpful. Please do subscribe to our channel, leave a like if you found this helpful, and please leave in the comments below if you will be interested in what distributions are actually suitable to model stock market dynamics.